Good morning. Today is the second Sunday in Ordinary Time. The second collection today is for the Catholic University of America. Our gathering song is number 310, Table of Plenty, 310.
Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, who govern all things, both in heaven and on earth, mercifully hear the pleading of your people and bestow your peace on our times. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. For Zion's sake, I will not be silent. For Jerusalem's sake, I will not be quiet until her vindication shines forth like the dawn and her victory like a burning torch. Nations shall behold your vindication, and all the kings your glory. You shall be called by a new name pronounced by the mouth of the Lord. You shall be a glorious crown in the hand of the Lord, a royal diadem held by your God. No more shall people call you forsaken or your land desolate, but you shall be called my delight and your land espoused. For the Lord delights in you and makes your land his spouse. As a young man marries a virgin, your builder shall marry you, and as a bridegroom rejoices in his bride, so shall your God rejoice in you. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, there are different kinds of spiritual gifts, but the same Spirit. There are different forms of service, but the same Lord. There are different workings, but the same God who produces all of them in everyone. To each individual, the manifestation of the Spirit is given for some benefit. To one is given through the Spirit the expression of wisdom. To another, the expression of knowledge according to the same Spirit. To another, faith by the same Spirit. To another, gifts of healing by the one Spirit. To another, mighty deeds. To another, prophecy. To another, discernment of spirits. To another, varieties of tongues. To another, interpretation of tongues. But one and the same Spirit produces all of these, distributing them individually to each person as he wishes. The word of the Lord.
From the Holy Gospel according to John. There was a wedding at Cana in Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Jesus and his disciples were also invited to the wedding. When the wine ran short, the mother of Jesus said to him, "They have no wine." And Jesus said to her, "Woman, how does your concern affect me? My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Now there were 6 stone water jars there for Jewish ceremonial washings, each holding 20 to 30 gallons. He told them, "Fill the jars with water." So they filled them to the brim. He told them, "Draw some out now and take it to the head waiter." So they took it. And when the head waiter tasted the water that had become wine, without knowing where it came from, although the servants who had drawn the water knew, the head waiter called the bridegroom and said to him, "Everyone serves good wine first, and then when people have drunk freely, an inferior one. But you have kept the good wine until now." Jesus did this as the beginning of his signs at Cana in Galilee, and so revealed his glory, and his disciples began to believe in him. The Gospel of the Lord. We have all seen in recent months in the media the pictures of so many families coming back to their homes that had been destroyed by the tornadoes or the wildfires. We can't even imagine what it must be like to come to your home and find everything destroyed, a lifetime of things you collected, all destroyed. How depressing, how sorrowful. And perhaps that helps us understand a little bit more how the Jews felt when they came back from their 70 years of exile in Babylon. The first words you heard today from the prophet Isaiah, for the last part of his book, are words addressed to them in that situation. They came back and found their beloved Jerusalem in ruins. Their homes, their shops, the walls that had protected their city all pulled down, the temple in ruins. Where to even begin to rebuild their lives? And at that moment, when they were so downcast, so depressed, God spoke to them a word of hope. He said, for Zion's sake, I will not be silent. For Jerusalem's sake, I will not be quiet. Even in the midst of all that sorrow and destruction, he gave a word of hope that all the nations would be coming to Jerusalem. The kings would come and admire the glory of their capital, their nation. You shall be a glorious crown in the hand of the Lord, a royal diadem held by your God. No more shall people call you forsaken and your land is vows. Yes, many of the Jews thought God had abandoned them, forgotten them, broken the covenant with them in letting them be conquered and taken into exile and their beloved city reduced to ruins. But the Lord said to them, the Lord delights in you and makes your land his spouse. As a young man marries a virgin, your builder, God, shall marry you. And as a bridegroom rejoices in his bride, so shall your God rejoice in you. Yes, he spoke to them as his beloved people. They had been chastised in exile. Now God was assuring them again that he would be with them, that they were his beloved. And those words addressed to God's people centuries ago are still spoken to you today. You are the beloved of your God. You are the ones he delights in. He sees in you the image of his Son. He sees in you goodness. He sees in you the truth of Christ living. Yes, our God has said to us in the new covenant, how much greater and more wondrous is this new relationship of God with his people than the old covenant was. And fittingly, we are given this gospel from John of the marriage feast of Cana. It is the third of the Epiphany mysteries. 2 weeks ago, we celebrated when Magi came to adore the Christ. Last week, we celebrated the second of the Epiphany mysteries, the baptism of the Lord. And today, the third, the marriage feast of Cana, the first of Jesus' miracles, in which God was manifesting, here he is, your Savior, my beloved Son, with power to change your world and your lives. We know according to the custom of the times, Jewish people celebrated a marriage for a whole week. So you can imagine how unruly the guests would be if there was no wine. And when Mary says that they have run out of wine, Jesus' answer seems to be so odd. My hour has not yet come. You know that on the cross, as he was about to die,
Jesus entrusted his beloved mother to Saint John, the youngest of the apostles, probably only a teenager at the time. And he took care of Mary until she passed away. You might expect John's gospel would mention her often, but it doesn't. There are only two times in the gospel when he speaks of Mary. One here at the wedding feast of Cana, when Jesus' hour had not yet come. And the second, when she stood beside the cross of Jesus with his blood dripping down upon her, his hour had come. The hour for him to suffer and die and rise again and so redeem our human race from all evil and sin and death itself. Yes, Mary interceded for that couple, and she continues to intercede for us. And we are told that Jesus changed the water into wine. Jars holding 20 to 30 gallons, six of them. Yes, that should have been enough wine for the rest of the celebration. And we're told that the head waiter, when he tested it, said, "This is the best wine." A subtle way of St. John saying, yes, this new covenant we have with our God is so much far superior to the old covenant, as wine was superior to just water, especially in that society, that world without sanitation. Yes, Jesus worked the first of his miracles in a wedding. And that speaks so clearly of the new relationship of God with us. How often during the Advent season and Christmas time, in some of the prayers of the church, it speaks of our relationship with God in terms of romance. God seeking out his beloved seeking the God who is the cause of our joy. Yes, in the whole Christmas Epiphany season, we have not only been celebrating the birth of a child, we have been celebrating a marriage, the marriage of the divine and the human in Christ, the marriage of heaven and earth, the marriage of our God with our human race for all who believe in Jesus. Yes, this is our dignity. And our God is revealing to us the depths of his love. I've read about many other religions in the history of the human race, but none of them ever dared to say that their God was so intimately involved in the life of his people as the Christian religion says, that our God has entered into such an intense, intimate bond of love. He says over and over, "I love you. You are my delight. I have married you in this covenant." Yes, and the church so often speaks in the nuptial prayers, in the weddings, recognizing that every one of you who has accepted the call to Christian marriage, your marriage is to all of us a reminder of God's marriage to all of us, his people. We are the bride of Christ. We are the ones he has loved. And you come here not only to hear that word, but to experience it in the Eucharist we are about to celebrate, this wondrous mystery in which we are lifted up out of time and space into that great moment of unselfish love as Jesus suffered and died for you, for me, for all of us. Yes, that is the moment in which our God has shown us the ultimate cost of his love. even to send his Son to the cross. And now he has poured forth his Spirit into our lives, the Spirit coming with all of his gifts, as St. Paul says, the Spirit we received at our baptism and confirmation, the Spirit who dwells within us and changes us day by day, year by year, into a closer union with Christ Jesus. He makes us the joyful children of God, members of the body of Jesus Christ, living temples of his Spirit. And because we are his children, we know that death is not the end. It is the beginning of our eternal life with our God. Yes, we give thanks to the God who has loved us and now calls us to respond with love to the one who has given all for us.
We renew our commitment of faith and love in the Lord Jesus as we pray the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, calls us to follow him and be united to him in his church. We pray for our church, our world, our nation, and our personal needs.
Today our response is, Lord, hear our prayer. For all Christians, that all may pray and work together to restore full unity to the Church of Christ, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That our fellow citizens and leaders may come to recognize the sacredness of every human life and protect the lives of unborn children, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That many will hear and accept the call of Jesus to serve him and his people as priests and religious, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the poor and hungry, for victims of injustice, violence, and abuse, for those without family or friends, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Dorothy Rich, Bob Davis, Patricia Darmanin, Jim Fadina Sr., Teresa Kelleher Cassidy, Patty Grimes, Judy Wilbank, and all the sick of our parish and families, that they find hope and strength in Jesus, we pray.
Lord, hear.
For John J. Loudon, for whom this Mass is being offered, and all who have completed their pilgrimage of life, that they receive their reward and eternal joy, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pause in silence to remember our personal needs. In confident trust, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord God, we pray for our beloved nation in this time of crisis and division. Send your Spirit upon all of us, that we may be united in mutual respect and work together to build a nation of justice, truth, and peace. This we pray through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Thank you.
that this sacrifice, my sacrifice and yours, will be acceptable to God, the Almighty and loving Father. Grant us, O Lord, we pray, that we may participate worthily in these mysteries. For whenever the memorial of this sacrifice is celebrated, the work of our redemption is accomplished through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For out of compassion for the waywardness that is ours, he humbled himself and was born of the Virgin. By the passion of the cross, he freed us from unending death, and by rising from the dead, he gave us life eternal. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. To your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. On the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
The mystery of faith. His wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven. And as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with Saint John and all your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint Helena and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth with your servant Francis, our Pope, and William, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, especially John Bowden, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, to whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church,
and graciously grant your peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
We share the sign of Christ's peace.
Thank you. Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son,
and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We go in the peace of Christ. Have a good day.
Going forth this morning, we will sing a new song, number 550. Sing a new song.